direct our thoughts and hearts and minds and attention this morning to this psalm, which I suppose in most copies of the Bible is a psalm of Asaph. Asaph was a Levite. He had been called by God and appointed by David to serve him in the tabernacle of the great musician. And he'd also written a number of psalms, and this is one of them. We believe, as God's people, that the Bible, beginning to end, is the Word of God. The Lord is speaking in a great variety of ways to lots of different people at different times. And that is a glorious thing. We remember, of course, that in the New Testament, Paul, in his second letter to Timothy, says that all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God and is profitable for us in all kinds of ways. In other words, in this book, we call the Bible the Word of God. We have what the Lord wants us to know, particularly and especially and supremely about himself. And so the glorious message of salvation we find here unveiled and revealed to us. Here in this psalm, there is a sense, I think, in which we could say God is moving and speaking differently to what he does normally, where we have the reports of what God has said, done, and going to do. By those who were here at the time, whether it's right back in the very beginning, or with Abraham, or Isaac, or David, or Solomon, or the prophets, the New Testament with the apostles and the gospel writers. But here we have, in the first six verses, Asaph writing as other psalmists and other writers of the Bible have done, telling us what is going to come and how the Lord is going to speak. But after that, God himself directly seems to take over. And in not being kind of reported, God says this, that, and the other. I am the Lord speaking to you. And this is the great theme that I want to lay before us this morning as we turn here to the Word of God himself. As we think about our Christian lives, there is so much that is absolutely true, but possibly we could say it is not the whole story. Yes, God has given to us great blessings and benefits and helps and aids all through our lives, from the very first day we trusted in him until the day we enter the heavenly glory. He provides us with himself our food day by day. He gives to us strength and health in our normal living. He gives to us peace when we're passing through times of difficulty and trouble. He's given to us eternal life. But none of this is just a kind of quality of life and living on its own. What God has actually done in his majesty and his glory and his love and his goodness and his grace and his mercy is to give us himself. And that is the great theme that comes to us here from what Asaph lays before us in his record. The first part of the psalm, God is speaking to his own people in a general kind of way, we could say, until he gets midway, when in verses 14 and 15 he becomes very specialized and specific. And he tells his people then, and of course it speaks to us today, this is what I want you to do and how I want you to behave. Not just out there in the world and in your daily lives, but in your relationship towards me. Offer to God thanksgiving and pay your vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you and you shall glorify me. We'll come to that in a while, but first of all, I want to set before us the mighty truth that we have in the Bible about God himself and his richness and his blessings. When we go back to the early days of the Bible, particularly to Moses and the Exodus and so on, the Lord gave to Moses a new name that he was to convey to the people of Israel. He was to say to them, tell them, I am, have sent you unto them. I am that I am. God did not say, this is what I was or I'm going to be. It is what he is eternally. And we should give thanks to God day after day, that while he is almighty, while he is, as we say, omnipotent, all-powerful, there are certain things God himself has said he cannot do. He cannot change. He cannot lie. He cannot deny himself. And this great truth is what sustained Moses through those years of trial and trouble and coming out of Egypt and going into the wilderness and towards the promised land and everything else. And when you come down through the message of the Bible and somebody like Jeremiah, we discover that God has something very special to say that should comfort his people in every age and generation. I have loved you with an everlasting love. A love that hasn't changed from before time began and will not change when time is over. A love that is consistent, a love that is constant, and a love that is glorious. We also find as we turn to the New Testament that Paul picks it up as well in his letter to the Romans, and he says, the love of God has been poured into our hearts by the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. This is so very different in the giving of God to what we find in the days of Moses out there in the wilderness when he received the commandments and the laws and the ordinances, the laws of God. There the language of God is very different. This is what you must do, this is what you mustn't do, this is what you must change, this is what you must alter. This is how you must come and worship. And in all of that, we have God saying to his people that when you sin, judgment will come. But the judgment that I give will be fair and absolutely just. And you know the expression that is used in those early days. If you commit a sin that's worthy of an eye, it is an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth. But when we come to this glorious message about the love of God, we find that God isn't measuring anything at all. As Paul puts it, he pours his love into our hearts. He hasn't got his gauge out. He hasn't got his bottles and his tubs and containers. He is giving his love gloriously, eternally, completely. What in judgment the children of Israel may have received if they sinned against God was what they deserved. What God gives to us in his love and goodness and grace and mercy is what we don't deserve, but what he has freely bestowed upon us. Why all of this? Because what I want to bring forth this morning, God has not merely given to us a lovely feeling. We read in the Bible the truth about him, his nature, his character, his personality. In this case, God is love. And therefore we can say, as we started off saying this morning, God has not just given to us benefits and blessings. He has given to us his very self. The psalmists understood this in those early days. We know, of course, the stories about David from that early time with Goliath and so on, and then afterwards when he was fleeing for his life from King Saul, who was trying to kill him, when he hid in the cave, when he went and lived amongst the Philistines for a time. But David understood the reality of what God was doing to him and for him. He wasn't just providing him with comforts in the cave or amongst the Philistines. He said to the Lord, Lord, you yourself are my rock and my fortress. And when he was fighting his battles, whether it was, I presume, against Goliath with his sling and his stones, or his sword against the enemies that came against him later, he didn't just say, God is giving me the strength to wield these weapons of war. He says to God, you yourself are my shield and my exceeding great reward. And when he's thinking about those times of blessing and joy that came to him and will have come to him later when he entered the heavenly glory. It isn't like the people of the world seem to imagine when they talk about this afterlife that's in their minds. When they're sitting somewhere up in the clouds and talking and chatting and enjoying their remembrances of things they did together here on earth. This is something that God in his goodness and greatness reveals to us of himself, both here and there. And the psalmist says to him, "You yourself are my glory and the lifter of my head." And we find this as we turn to the New Testament. The Lord Jesus takes up the same kind of theme as in my younger days we used to talk about the great I Ams of John's Gospel, where the Lord Jesus, John records, spoke of himself in this kind of way. "I haven't just come," he says, "to show you how to go. I haven't just come to point you in the right direction. I haven't just come to tell you certain things that are true about God and heaven and everlasting life. I haven't just come to give you the life itself. I myself am the way. I myself am the truth. I myself am the light." Matthew tells us about the prayer that we often pray together here, called, we call it the Lord's Prayer. I'm sure it isn't. The Lord didn't have to pray, "Forgive us our sins." We do. But it's a prayer he gave to us. And we pray in that prayer according to his direction. "Give us this day our daily bread." And whether we think of that in terms of the food upon the table at home, or the nourishment that we need in the welfare and goodness of our souls as we travel through this earthly life, the Lord Jesus isn't just providing us with good things to enjoy. He says, does he not, "I myself am the bread of life." And so as we look at all of this, you may wonder, well, what's that got to do with our psalm here this morning? Well, I just want to read to you a few verses that we have in Revelation chapter 19 that John records for us. Things that he's recording, he has seen and witnessed there in heaven. And in chapter 19 he says, "Now I saw heaven opened, and behold a white horse, and he who sat on him was called Faithful and True." Obviously this is the Lord Jesus. "And in righteousness he judges and makes war. His eyes were like a flame of fire, and on his head were many crowns. He had a name written that no one knew except himself." But now he's going to tell us what it is. "And he said he was clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God." John picks this up, doesn't he, in the beginning of his gospel, as he starts to write not about Bethlehem and the virgin birth and the shepherds and the wise men and all those things the others talk about. He starts off with this great theme and message about the nature and the character of God himself. "In the beginning was" who? "The Word." And the Word, the Lord Jesus, was God. And the Word was with God. All things were made by him, and he likes to repeat himself, "and without him was not anything made that was made. In him himself was life, and the life was the light of men." And later he says, "and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." One of the great wonders of the Christmas story we often don't deal with at Christmas time, because it comes a week or so after Bethlehem, the shepherds and the wise men, it seems, and all that took place there. When he was 8 days old, Luke tells us about this, Mary and Joseph brought the baby up to Jerusalem, presumably still from Bethlehem, to do for him, he explains, according to the requirements of the law. Offerings had to be made, And he was going to experience in that little body the first of the pains that he would endure while he was here in this world for us. He would need to be circumcised. They would bring him to the temple and all of this would be accomplished there. And there was in the temple, it seems as though he always lived there, a man called Simeon, a godly man, who was old. And it seemed as though he was looking forward to dying and going to be with the Lord. But as we're thinking about increasingly here this morning, God has spoken to him. And he said to him, Simeon, you're not going to die yet. This isn't the time. Not until you have seen the Lord's anointing. And there must have been hundreds of families coming and going in the temple during those days, months and years. God again spoke to him when the time of the day came. Simeon, here they are. And he seemed to understand because he went across to Mary and Joseph and took the baby in his arms, presumably from Mary. And he held him in his arms and looked at him and he said to the Lord, Lord, I'm ready to die. Let now your servant depart in peace. Why? What's happened? Well, my eyes have seen not your Savior, but your salvation. A light to lighten me, people of God, and bring glory of you into this human world. Now, this little baby is the one who we read about in the very beginning of the Bible, though it isn't clear there until we come to the New Testament, where the Lord Jesus spoke and brought everything into being. There it was very different. Genesis, we read, in the beginning God made heavens and the earth and everything in them, and God said, and it was the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word of God. He wasn't talking to anything or anybody, because there was nothing there. It was by his words of command and authority that everything came to be. Heavens, the earth, what is on the earth and under the earth and in the earth, the creatures, the birds of the air, the fish in the sea, the creatures, the trees, the flowers and everything. Oh, and yes, and the Bible says, so it's an afterthought. He made the stars too. There's God who is almighty in his words. Here, in the arms of Simeon at this moment, this almighty God is unable to say a word. He hasn't spoken. He hasn't done anything. He's just lying there, completely reliant upon this moment, this man of God, and when he goes back to Joseph, and to Mary to care for him. And yet, this tiny baby, presumably lying silent and gazing up at this man, spoke. In himself, he is the message. He is the Word of God. And God is, in and through the Bible, from beginning to end, constantly speaking. And may I say as well, when he doesn't appear to be just speaking, God is praying, do we believe? Let's remind ourselves of that. I want to just pass on to you, some of you may have heard some of this before, but a lot of you won't have known, some personal stories that show the reality of this. The Bible tells us, in the New Testament particularly, that when we come to a point in our prayer life, we find it difficult to pray and don't know where to start and finish. The Holy Spirit takes over and intercedes for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. We had an experience of this during our time in Brixton. We were there 18 months to start with. And something terrible happened in Brixton on a Saturday morning towards the end of September. The police raided a home to try and arrest young man they were looking for, and the young man's mother got in the way, and Mrs. Cherry Groves was shot and she died. And there was uproar throughout Brixton. We had that afternoon a wedding in the church buildings, and fortunately, in the mercies of God, the reception was away from the the centre of Brixton. We knew nothing about what was happening in that afternoon and that night time. Until when we tried to leave the reception, we found it very difficult to get home. When we got back, I put on the television to see what on earth was going on and was horrified at what I saw. 9:45, my phone rang. And one of our ladies who lived across the road from the chapel phoned to say, the furniture shop next door with the flat supply was on fire from end to end. The fire brigade are trying to save the chapel. I sank down by the side of the settee and I prayed the most powerful prayer I've ever prayed. Just 2 words. Oh God. And I believe still with all my heart that that was when, obviously, the Holy Spirit interceded for us with groanings that could not be uttered. We got back in the car, we weren't living nearby then, we hadn't come across yet. We came back to Brixton, and the police led us through the barriers when we told them who we were and why we were coming. Promises, if you see trouble, turn around and get out of Dodge. I didn't need to be told that. When we got there, we did turn the car around in case we needed to move quickly. Walked down to the junction where the chapel is. People everywhere. Vehicles upside down, cars burned out, police all over the place. There was no fire, no fire brigade, and no building next door. I asked the police what had happened, and they said, about 9:45. And the Holy Spirit prayed for us. The building next door fell to its down on either side into the two streets, and the fire went out, and the fire brigade went. God has a voice. And in heaven we're told the Lord Jesus Christ enters to make intercession for us. I don't believe myself that he's sitting up there constantly saying to the Father at his side, Father, it's okay, I died for these people, let them stay. It is his very person that speaks of the glorious salvation that he has provided for us. He is himself the Word, the truth, the glory and the majesty of God. God does speak to us today. And I think sometimes, because you're like me, there are times when we're not aware that God has actually done the speaking. And it seems like what we had was a good idea, something of that sort. Let me just tell you one or two personal things. We were 3 children in our family. We grew up through the war years, living in London, all the bombing and everything else. And when it was all over, I don't remember how it all started, but Mum and Dad sent us to Sunday school on Sunday afternoons. It wasn't a church, it was a mission, a children's mission, it was called that, staffed by Christians from different churches. And we would go there. And I remember, I must have been about 10 at the time, I suppose, hearing my mother say, presumably to Dad, that she'd been talking to somebody outside the family and saying why they sent us. And her explanation was she thought, they thought, it was good for us to know about these things. They weren't Christians, they weren't interested. They knew nothing at all about them, but they were happy. I picked up, I think it was, say, about 10, but she said, when they're 14, they can decide whether they want to keep going or not. And I thought, I'm looking forward to that. But Mum and Dad weren't aware of the fact that God was in control of us and our lives. And we were converted, we were saved, we were born again, however you want to put it. And our lives were transformed. And they were furious. I remember, you know, later on when we were married and a little boy, we took to see an old auntie, sister of my dad, living down in Dover. And obviously Mum and Dad were moaning to them about what they had to put up with at home. My aunt Maggie, as we called her, suddenly rounded on me in the sitting room of her little home and said, you're just like your Uncle Joe, you are. I didn't know Uncle Joe. He was the firstborn of their family. He was in the army during the First World War, and he was killed in the army during fighting in 1917. Why am I like Uncle Joe? Well, he was always on his knees saying, We called him Holy Joe. He used to go to that there church and the Elephant and Castle called the Tabernacle. And my heart leapt for joy. Uncle Joe was a Spurgeon's man. Later on, and they were getting older, Dad died, and I was going up and down to see my brother and sister. And each time as I had left, I suppose it was the same with Anna and Rose, Mum started crying, she was on her own. And I used to think to myself, what can I do to comfort her? She doesn't want to know the gospel. She doesn't want to be comforted in any of these ways. But on this occasion, I put my raincoat on and standing there, there she was crying. And then I adjusted my armour. The Christian armour that Paul talks about in Ephesians, we shall help on straits, my breastplate was there, and I got out my shield of faith, and I said to her, Mum, you know what the answer is? And she said to me, yes, can I do? And I've been wanting to talk to you about it for ages. She hadn't spoken to anyone. Nobody had spoken to her. She hadn't read the Bible. She didn't have one. She'd not been to church. Who had done the evangelizing? Jesus says, didn't he, when he was going back to the glorious heaven above, to the disciples, you go and preach the gospel to every creature. But he's quite capable of doing it himself. And he certainly did on this occasion. I took my raincoat off and kept me on the wall. And we sat down and we sat together that night. She gave her heart to Christ. I was very late. Morning was in bed, asleep, woke when I gave in. You're very late. Yes, love, I'm sorry. I couldn't get away. Mum became a Christian tonight. Oh. She was? And she had moment on. How different things were. She was baptized when she was 18. We had a brother in the church we were in Brixton, named Jim. He must have been there, I don't know, a year, 18 months, or something like that. It was after a Sunday morning service, I don't know what I was preaching. Now, of course, it was a long time ago. But after the service, Jim came to me, absolute misery written all over his face. Can I talk to you? We went into the vestry and I said, Jim, what on earth is wrong? With agony written all over his face, he said to me, Pastor, why doesn't God speak to me? I looked at him and said, Jim, why have you come to me? I want you to help me. No, I will. But what I mean, Jim, is there are thousands of people on the streets of Brixton this morning and out here in West Norwood as well who don't care whether there is a God, let alone whether he's talking to them. Why are you concerned, hungry, thirsty, passionate, longing, wanting? He sat there looking at me. His eyes got bigger and bigger and bigger. I thought they were coming out of his head. And a smile went across his face from ear to ear. And he lifted his hands. He said, Pastor, it's because God is talking to me. I didn't realize it. But see, that's the problem. I didn't realize it. I thought it was me seeking him. But it's him seeking. And he got up and literally danced out of the vestry, saying as he went back to the main body of the church, this is wonderful. God is speaking to me. Just one more. In the year before we got married, I was working in those days in the City of London for a bank whose name officially was called a Belgian bank. London subsidiary part of the biggest bank in those days in Belgium. I was sent over to Brussels for a year to see what the head office was doing and how it did and all that kind of thing. In those days, there were missionaries of the law in Belgium because a large part of Africa was under Belgian control, the Belgian Congo. And the Belgian authorities insisted that anybody going into Congo to teach heal, whatever it was, had to go through their courses and things before they went there. And so the house in which I was living, there were about 10 missionaries constantly coming and going from different parts of the world. We all went to the same church, French church, speaking church, but I joined in one of the suburbs some folk who were teaching in a Sunday school. It was called the École Internationale Dimanche, which translates as the International Sunday School, except it wasn't very international, it was American. And I think I was the only international one there. But I had a class of boys, they were about 10. I called them the three J's, John, Mark, John, and Jerry. I still pray for them. If I still think of them as 10 years old, they must be grown for us now. But we met Sunday after Sunday in the mornings. And one week as I was preparing the lesson for them, we had a book to follow and so on, I closed my Bible when I finished, and I thought, says I, to myself, what would it be like to teach this in French? And I got out my French Bible and sat there and went through it all again in French. And didn't think at all about it anymore until I got to my class on Sunday morning and discovered I'd got four boys. John Mark had brought a friend from school, a Belgian boy who didn't speak English. And that morning we had the lesson, English, French, English, French, English, French, right the way through. Was I being clever? Or was God speaking? I knew nothing about this little lad coming to join us that Sunday morning, possibly the only time he'd heard the word of God. But the Lord did. God is the living word. He himself is the message. And now, just to come to these two verses we have in the very heart of all of this, because this is important too in view of what God says. Offer to God thanksgiving and pay your vows to the Most High. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you. You heard that before somewhere. And you shall glorify me. I want to take it in reverse order for this reason. As at the end there, God gives to us, in a few words, a great purpose that he has in mind for your life and for mine. This is his purpose. This is why he saved us. This is what he's brought us here for this morning. You shall glorify me. In earlier days, in churches in this country and in others, people were taught the truth of God's word before they became church members and so on. And part of it was called in those days a catechism. And there were exposed different ones, different questions and answers, which people had to learn and think of the scriptures where they came from. This one comes from something that's called the Westminster Confession of Faith. The very first question which was asked and the answer which was expected was this. What is the chief end of man? What is all about? What's it for? The answer that those interviewing the person wanting to become a church member and go on to the Lord and everything was this. The chief end of man is to glorify God. Enjoy him forever. In other words, this is not just a duty. This is not just a kind of responsibility, religious or otherwise. This is the way God brings us into this place of glory where we will serve him and be with him forever and forever. Offer to God thanksgiving. Pay your vows to the Most High. This idea of thanksgiving is something that is entrenched in the heart of God. He is to be thanked. He is to be praised. And when we look at the book of Revelation and read a song for the saints are singing there, not the angels, but the saints, the angels are forgiven. They haven't sinned, but we have. And those who are there are praising him and thanking him for what he has done, how he has paid the penalty for our sins, how how he has brought us at last to that heavenly city. Thanksgiving here on earth should be part of our life, accompanied by our vows, our promises, our commitments to the Most High. We're not here just to expect God to bless what we're doing day by day, he does that. We are here to serve him what we're doing day by day and to put him first. I'm still often amazed in those years I spent in the city of London in the bank there. I didn't go around preaching and evangelizing. That was not what I was paid to do. I was paid to work. But somehow everybody seemed to know that I was a Christian and what I believed. It's one of those odd things that to me only God could have brought about. On the occasion when we had a new managing director, something new for us, he was an Englishman out of Belgium. Within a matter of days, he knew all about me, but he hadn't spoken to me yet. That seems to me to be how we should be living our lives, even if it's not a deliberate and a conscious effort on our part. The verse and portion I want to just focus on with you now is absolutely personal. Call upon me in the day of trouble. I will deliver you. In my business days, I met a young man, a Christian, who told me that he and his wife had a little girl, and she was very ill with something or other, I don't remember the details. And in their church, they believed in praying for the sick particularly. And they've been doing this, and nothing seemed to be happening. And he said to me, and I had no answer at that time, when people came to Jesus when he was here, they didn't have to ask twice. Why do we have to ask hundreds of times and still seem to get no answer? And over these recent years, I have had to sit down, and I was going to say when I was preparing this, spoke to myself, but I don't think I was talking to myself. I think God was talking to myself. As I began to reason this, and I pray, I believe with real faith, like the man who came to Jesus said, you don't have to do a big thing in campaigns and all of that. Just say the word, and it shall be done. But it wasn't. And somehow, I began to think about all of this. The first thing that came to me was, Ken, when the Lord says to you, ask and ye shall receive, seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened to you. That's not the only thing he says about prayer and what will happen. You have taken the approach that somehow the Lord is no longer on the throne, but you are. You're kind of giving your orders and expecting him to run around and carry them out. Rather like when you go to a restaurant, which I love doing, and you sit there and a waitress or a waiter comes and you say, oh, this, and this, they go, when I fetch it? And you enjoy it. You don't get to pay for it, but at least you get it. And they do all the work. It isn't like that in God. He is the one who is on the throne. And we are the ones who are coming to him. Take what God says in its fullness. What he says elsewhere, Paul brings out to us in his letter to the Philippians. What he says, in everything, that means nothing gets left out, in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And then he makes this marvelous promise on behalf of God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, shall guard, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and the love of God, and of Jesus Christ our Lord. And again, just to remind ourselves, Paul says elsewhere, that the peace of God isn't just a nice feeling. When he was talking, as we prayed earlier, and Mark praying, leading us in prayer for what's happening in the Middle East, Paul says about Jews and Gentiles, he himself is our peace. And we would say to that, yes, hallelujah. And he himself is the one who's broken down the middle wall of partition between us and the living God. Make your requests known to him. And there's another statement which our Lord gives to us himself in the Gospels. Whatever, here we go, you ask in my name, I will do it. And I've had through these recent years to sit down and ask myself, and the Lord's been challenging me with it. What does that mean? We come to God all the time in Jesus' name. We can't come any other way. He is the way, the truth, and the life, as we've reminded ourselves this morning. What does it mean to pray in his name? And it's come slowly, but it's come surely. It has to mean this. That we come to God and we pray, not my will, but yours be done. What is it, Lord, that you have in mind? You who chose us from the foundation of the world. You who wrote our names in the Lamb's Book of Life before the foundation of the world. You who were in the plan and purpose of God slain for us before the foundation of the world, until it was confirmed and brought to pass at Calvary. Here we have God in full command of everything. I want you, he says, to come and seek what I want. Remind ourselves of the Lord Jesus and what he went through. We just said that he has set apart and agreed with the Father and the Holy Spirit there before Adam was fallen out of the dust of the earth. Before he sinned, they were ready for this. And as soon as he had sinned that evening, God himself preached the gospel, you remember. The seed of one shall bruise a serpent's head. And all through those years of what we read about in the Old Testament, the history, the story, prophecies and everything else, our Lord Jesus Christ, as we know him now, knew that that day was coming ever, ever nearer. Still the same day in heaven, but in earth's time here upon earth. Until, as we reminded ourselves earlier, he was conceived in the womb of a virgin, born and laid in a manger of Bethlehem, and grew up and performed his ministry. We come to that time when he was there in the garden, prayed. It's interesting that he seems, when he prayed, to pray out loud because the disciples heard and recorded it. And on this occasion, the agony and the awfulness, perhaps the terror, the pain, the humbling, the humiliation, the crushing, everything seemed to be pouring in upon him. Judas hadn't arrived yet. And the writer says, his perspiration was like great drops of blood. And they heard him pray, Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. Coming to him, trusting him, absolute faith, devotion, submission, giving him the honor and the glory which belongs to him alone. There is an old hymn I want to read to you now that has been such a blessing and a help and instruction to me over these past years. Interestingly, I've never sung it in church. It's not been in the hymn books when I've been worshipping at different times. It's written by a man called John Newton. here 200 or more years ago. His earlier life was awful. He was a slave trader until he came to know and to love the Lord Jesus. And you've met him, not in person, of course, but in one of the great hymns which everybody seems to know and we love to sing. And that is Amazing Grace. How sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. He says, God spoke to me. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear. And grace my fears removed. How precious did that grace appear. The hour I first believed. And then in that special verse that seems in a sense out of joint, he tells us the trials and troubles which he has been facing and going through in his Christian life. I remember as a young fellow, now and again we would go to something called an evangelistic service where a preacher would preach the gospel and hopefully people would be saved. And sometimes, even as a young fellow, I thought to myself, that's not right. The preacher would say, if you come to Jesus, all your troubles will be over. And I'd sit there thinking to myself about our home life, let alone anything else. That's when all mine started. And it's not to be surprised at. Satan isn't very pleased when Jesus steps in and takes us out of Satan's kingdom of darkness and brings us into his own kingdom of light. And when he hears that God has forgiven the sins which Satan was delighted he were committing. There he says in that lovely hymn, through many dangers, toils, and snares, I have already come. 'Tis grace hath brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. And then that last verse, talking about heaven, he can only write about it in the language of earth. Because he's got no other language. None of us have here. Where would we be there? I used to sing 10,000 years. Bright shining as the sun, with no less days to sing God's praises. And when we first began, has it occurred to you that nobody you've known and loved or have heard about, read about in the New Testament or anywhere else has been in heaven for a day yet? There is no night there. The day is everlasting, eternal, without end. And the light of heaven is not the light of the sun or the moon or electric lights or anything else. John tells us again in the Revelation, the light of heaven is the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb, and they are the glory of it. And they don't go away, and they don't go to sleep. And so when the time comes and God speaks to us and says, the time's come for you to leave where you are, go home. He's not going to call you. He's not going to send you. He's going to take you. Because he's already here. And he's not just with us, but within us, dwelling within these bodies of ours as a living temple. In the years after the end of the Second World War, I think just thinking of London, let alone the rest of the country, there were ruins everywhere. Buildings that were still standing were battered and knocked about, and others were very old. And the language the government was using at the time was, these buildings are not fit for human habitation. We must make new homes for them to live in. And I can see the Lord saying to me sometime, not too distant future now. Ken, the time has come. This old temple we've been living in for so long together is worn out. Let's go home. Don't pack anything. Don't try to take anything. Leave it all behind. The former things have passed away, and everything has become new. And Jesus has prepared a home for you. In the heavens. This hymn I want to read to you, as I said, has spoken to me, and really I'm going to finish with this. His experience, his testimony, and his ministry as well. If you would like a copy of it afterwards, do come and see me. I've got quite a few. It'd be lovely to get rid of them all and know that you are blessed as well with these words. I asked the Lord that I might grow in faith and love and every grace, might more of his salvation know, and seek more earnestly his face. 'Twas he who taught me, speaking to me, how to pray, and he, I trust, has answered prayer. But it has been in such a way as almost drove me to despair. I hoped that in some favoured hour, at once he'd answer my request, and by his love's constrained power, subdue my sins and give me rest. Instead of this, he made me feel the hidden evils of my heart, and let the angry powers of hell assault my soul in every part. Yes, more, with his own hand he seemed intent to aggravate my woe, crossed all the fair designs I spun, blasted my fruits, and lay me low. Lord, why is this? I trembling cried. Wilt thou pursue my soul to death? 'Tis in this way, the Lord replied. I answer prayer for grace and faith. These inward trials I employ, from self and pride, to set thee free, to break thy schemes of worldly joy, that thou mayest seek